Grace, mercy, and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our friend. Amen. A couple mature in their years went to the doctor for their yearly physicals. One at a time, the doctor brings them into the examination room, starting with the husband. "Well, Mr. Smith," he says, "you're in great shape for a man your age." The man replies, "Well, doc, I don't drink, I don't smoke, and the good Lord looks after me." "What do you mean?" asks the doctor. "Well," the man says, "for instance, last night in the middle of the night, I had to get up and go to the bathroom, and the good Lord turned on the light for me so I wouldn't fall down." "That's nice," said the doctor, a little confused. "Send your wife in now, please." The wife comes in and the doc says, "Mrs. Smith, you're in great shape for a woman your age." She then says, "Well, doc, I don't drink, I don't smoke," and the doctor interrupts, "and the good Lord looks after you, right?" The woman is confused, and she says, "What are you talking about?" "Well," the doctor explains, "your husband was just telling me the same thing. He said the good Lord looks after him. Like last night when he had to go to the bathroom, the good Lord turned on the light for him." And the woman looks up, totally terrified, and she says, "Oh no, he went in the refrigerator again." Let's clean things up a bit, shall we? Bryn and I, we make this homemade laundry detergent. It's awesome. If you're on Pinterest, you can find it there. It's with like borax and Neftal soap or whatever that is, and OxyClean, but all of those ingredients mixed together, they work really well to make our brights brighter and our whites whiter, and it's more economic. It lasts for months and months and months. After all, in today's gospel, we hear about how Jesus was transfigured and his clothes became dazzling white, Mark says, such as no one on earth could ever bleach them. Vicar Kevin could probably use some of that after all those clothes he went through last weekend, right? It takes a lot of work, a lot of energy to try to be all things to all people as the gospel was interpreted for us last week. So the question that the Transfiguration tackles today is this: what if I can't? What if I fail? What if I am terrified? And so we celebrate the Transfiguration of our Lord because when we can't shine any brighter, our Lord can and does on our behalf. We may not have the ability to be all things to all people all the time. Hard as Paul tried, he was also human and fell short again and again. But we can try harder every day to be more like Christ, who is, by nature, fully human and fully God. He is all in all. So what does it really mean to be transfigured? It's kind of like the transformation that occurs when a caterpillar turns into a butterfly. So it's this verb, right, that means to change into another form. In the case of the transfiguration of Jesus, it means to match the reality of the outside with what's on the inside, like becoming who you were always meant to be. Mark is suggesting that Jesus is showing his friends, the people who would one day be bearers of this good news to all the world, who he truly is on the inside. And so, in this way, the transfiguration of our Lord is a foreshadowing of the transformation that we'll witness and experience as we live into the upcoming season of Lent, a season of contemplation and prayer. Today, we not only celebrate our Lord's transfiguration, but as a church, we are also intimately connected with our area outdoor ministries and want to share the awesome resources that we have here in Central PA through the Lutheran Camping Corporation. We are blessed with 3 Lutheran camps in our area: Kirkenwald, Nowakwa, and the Whittle Farm. The summer before I went to college, I served as a counselor at Virginia's Finest, the one and only outdoor ministry camp in the entire state, called Caroline Furnace. The summer before I went to seminary, So 4 years later, right after college, I served as a counselor at Nowaqua. Many of you have either served at one of our camps or attended as a camper. And if you never have, well, then you have a lot to look forward to. We have a special thing going on in our Lutheran camps. Of course, like all things human-made, like Brynn and my detergent, or in some decisions that we make, or in paths we take in life, there will always be room for improvement, room for further development. And every day we have the chance to nurture that growth as we seek to be like Christ in the world. For me, outdoor ministries are a glimpse of God's kingdom on earth. Camp is a place where I experience this quote by Mahatma Gandhi coming to life. He said this, the day the power of love overrules the love of power, the world will know peace. And this is because the world loves power. In the Transfiguration of Jesus, he shows us how the power of love overrules the love of power in the world. It's not ultimately power that corrupts, but the way power is used. In other words, the way we treat one another determines how God's light and life and love are experienced in the world. That's what Gandhi is pointing to here. How the use of power can be the difference between being hungry or being fed, between experiencing homelessness or obtaining shelter, between living and dying. This week, our White House confirmed the death of 26 years young Kayla Mueller, who had been held captive by ISIS militants. The story really hits home for me. I will be 29 next month. My first trip out of the country was when I was 17. I was serving with Physicians for Peace, which is an organization very similar to what Kayla was serving with. She was serving with Spanish Doctors Without Borders. Kayla went with a full heart of selfless love, eager to relieve suffering by the power of love in God's work, her hands, and her life was taken away by the love of power made known in a senseless airstrike. But in a letter to her family, mailed by Kayla's cellmates who had been released, she wrote these words, "I've come to a place in my experience where, in every sense of the word, I have surrendered myself to our Creator, because literally there was no one else. And by God and by your prayers, I have felt tenderly cradled. I have been shown in darkness light," she says, "and have learned that even in prison, one can be free, and I'm grateful. I've come to see that there is good in every situation. Sometimes we just have to open our eyes to see it, to form a bond of love and support among one another. I can think of nothing more powerful to express the meaning of transfiguration in the world that we live in. Kayla was showing her family what it means to match the reality of the outside with the inside. With an outward expression of light shining in darkness, she wrote about freedom in Christ while in captivity. Mark's gospel speaks to the emotions felt by Jesus' disciples, his followers, as they witnessed a light that obliterates darkness. He says they were terrified. I imagine and I hope that Jesus' disciples, Peter, James, John, and Kayla, that they believed they were not alone, that they knew God was with them in their most terrifying and dark moment. The Transfiguration is a moment at which the divine nature of Jesus is put on display for us to see in the light that faith overcomes our fear, In an instant, we are empowered to prepare for a journey with Jesus that we cannot and should not even try to control. Barbara Brown Taylor once said something profound about this journey of faith. It speaks not only to our life's path, but also to how we move liturgically in the church through the seasons from Transfiguration to Lent. She said, "We expect life to be a train ride, that we pick the right train and get off at the right stop when our destination is complete, when our journey is really like a sailboat. When we experience shifting winds, changing currents, the strength and disaster of storms every day. The transfiguration of Jesus is that crack of lightning, the rush of electricity that stops us in our tracks, that terrifies us, and tenderly reveals to us the power of love." How fitting the message is for this Valentine's weekend, to gain a true perspective on the power of love in our lives. An American film and TV producer named Joss Whedon, who co-created Toy Story and The Avengers, he said this, "Recognizing power in another does not diminish your own. In fact, and in my words, it's the place where love can be realized fully, the place where Christ's light shines the brightest. The Gospel of Mark speaks all kinds of repudiation against selfish, egotistical, what we would call power grab, as idolatry, when we'd rather worship our success, our money, our possessions, and ourselves over and against showing love for God and for our neighbor." Jesus' mission was not to puff himself up or to make a big deal of himself or to elevate his followers, for that matter, to positions of power or prestige by association with him. No, his mission was to point beyond himself to God and to invite his followers to one day find their voice in bearing witness to the countercultural God of grace. God's power is perfected through our capacity to love one another in community. So what will that look like for you this week? How can you shed light on God's love in the world, in your neighborhood, at work, or at school? You have the power to decide how to use what God has given you, to share a deeply radical and holy love that you were given even before you were created. Go forth from here, sent by God's love, remembering you are his holy and beloved child. You are loved. Amen.